complicated and three-quarter of the piece for that. So let me focus on everything afterwards. So I really need to have in falling vacuum at all times. I have to in falling vacuum for some pair of modes, EMP filled it. This is a collection of all people who already sat in. And I'm mapping the B2s of the partner mode from inside the black hole all the way to that Hilbert space gap. The state that's defined by all the BT Hilbert pairs just specifies some state in M. There's no larger Hilbert space that I can talk about. And it completely specifies it. Sometimes it overdetermines it, but it's not easy looking at this. It's very easy to specify the unique state in M. It's a pure state, but it would be unique, and that's a problem because it doesn't depend on the in state, and no information would be lost. So this is the reason why attempts to apply complementarity to the firewall problem have focused on unconventional types of maps. A unitary map of the infolding vacuum to the out state overdetermines the out state, and maybe gives you a unique out state that would activate those information. But before I go to these unconventional maps, which for some of the obvious have something called donkey maps, before I just want to give one last phrase to hold back complementarity, because we're about to see how much more consistent it looks than what I'll describe next. Both-matter complementarity is doing just fine if we apply it to the falling matter only. It's causal, in that we can allow the information to come out with a delay of one scrambling time after something falls in, and so you never have a problem with being rabbit, to bring it back to the thing that fell in to see two copies of the information. It's linear, the math doesn't get confused if you take a superposition of two quantum states, so we know what to do. All of this is wonderfully consistent with the regime in which the pullback push forward procedure is actually applicable, which is for one scrambling time after the most recent pull. After that, if you try to pull something back, even further back, and this is something that Joe and collaborators pointed out, you're effectively using trap spike in mode in the procedure, so you don't really have control over it. So this suggests that indeed what happens is that a firewall forms after the scrambling time, you throw something into the black hole, further out after the new scrambling time, the new firewall forms in mode. Okay, so now let's, before I get to nothing maps, let me talk about situations where no map is defined at all. So I'll talk about some of the limits in the next two sections. One is the limit where I'm basically connecting to my first few remarks about double purity being the problem. If the zone by itself is pure, it's already clear that it cannot be part of the vacuum state. There's no identification I can do between the interior and something far away that will change this fact. The question is whether we should care or not. I'll try to argue that we should care about this. The second limit that we can study is where the zone is entangled in just the right way, that by itself, it's in the same state whether you think of it as being part of the vacuum state, or whether you think of it as being part of the out state that's reduced to the zone. So in that case, there's perhaps some hope for a map operate. Okay, so let me start with the pure zone and try to convince you that this alone gives you a conflict with the equivalence principle. So, to make things as easy for me as possible, I'm going to worry about only one observer who happens to fall in at the time t and try to make things smooth for her. Now, the most general map that we can possibly consider is if there's a many-to-one map where we take the out state, whatever it is, and map it to the inside and the outside of the horizon, the near horizon feature and the interior, at the time t, in such a way that no matter what the altitude is, we get the vacuum at the horizon. And the effect of this is quite trivial. The problem is that the outstate and the new horizon region both contain the zone and the subset. And a general map, if I'm not careful, is going to assign two inconsistent states to the zone. In particular, if the outstate is such that the reduced density matrix just for the zone and T is not thermal, not the one that I would have gotten by starting with the vacuum instability input, then there is no identification I can make of the interior with any other system that's going to take the fact that the exterior is already in the wrong state to be part of the vacuum. And actually, I thought about the pure zone, but that's just the most extreme example. As soon as the zone state is not the thermal state, I cannot make any identification that will turn it into part of the vacuum. The following slide, I will try to argue some of the points. Now, the first is that while you might say that these kind of states are quite special, they're not generic in some sense, they're not that special in the difference that they expand the microcanonical ensemble of a platform. And secondly, if we accept that, then I think we also have to accept that this alone is already a problem and a conflict with the equivalence principle, even if more generic states did not have fireballs. Now then, company more generic states deal with this separately. So here's my argument for why these states expand the microcanonical ensemble. So let's look at a black hole in a box coupled to a heat map. This is essentially the same thing. Of course, this is considering a black hole, a box black hole in EDS, but I think there's no particular reason to restrict it to that setting. We don't have to put it in a box so that the ensemble flow is fine. But of course, the states that I talked about, if I think they arise, for black hole in the box, like it always could give a hole in the box and have some people into the black hole at a different time than the other one. So the question, what kind of an object is the black hole? Is it like any other thermodynamic object or not? I'm going to assume that it is. Black hole thermodynamics is valid, it gives our identity, and then it has a statistical interpretation. And that's going also the canonical, that the microcanonical ensemble works in the same way as a coin does. That's not the case of the argument. So what do we know about the black hole? Well, we know for sure that the black hole consists of the zone, in the sense that, well, these are 800 degrees of freedom that I can extract from the black hole, so that they're here to be exchanged with the beta. Now, a lot of the arguments are trying to develop maps to get rid of firewalls also appeal to additional degrees of freedom, perhaps horizon or membrane degrees of freedom. So, in order to include this, we should include this in order to these arguments be covered by what I'm going to discuss. So there's some extra degrees of freedom page, which by definition are not semi-classically accessible. In particular, H, the equation H has to come out somehow, and if H is not semi-classically accessible directly, then the only way it can happen is that by coupling to the zone mode, as they get redshifted, as they move away from the horizon, at some point they come under the cutoff, they're part of the semi-classical regime, or similarly when they fall back in, they go over the cutoff, and that's the place where we can allow them to interact with H, but not somewhere else, otherwise like we could access H directly. So H does not come coupled directly to the in depth, but through the zone D. The picture that at least I have in mind is you have a cavity, a black body cavity, the outside wall of a couple of eight box, there's a black body radiation, and then an interior hover of a ball that interacts very locally near the surface of the ball with this radiation, so it's indirectly coupled to the heat mass as well. So now I would argue that for any large subsystem of a thermodynamic system in a canonical ensemble, the entropy is additive. What do we know about the entropy? Thermodynamics, because the total entropy, to be A over 4, doesn't actually matter in this argument that it's A over 4. Let's just say it's big. FDH, the two systems together, have some entropy. Some additivity implies that the separate entropies of these two systems, at least that, if they're greater than A over 4, then there is some mutual information between the two systems. But I would argue that to be defined B, to be degrees of freedom that can be exchanged for the heat mass, definable degrees of freedom. Therefore, in this particular case, we know that FD plus H must be equal to the black hole entropy, because otherwise mutual information would build up between the heat mass and the black hole, and the entropy in equilibrium would not be constant. So, as a result of the canonical entropy being additive, the same thing is like if D and H is separate systems, each controlled by the temperature of the heat mass, they go over to the microcanonical ensemble separately for each of them. Now, maybe I have to exclude some very small layer, which would also be true for the ball hovering inside the black body cavity, where there's an interaction region or FOC control, but this will affect only a small subset of degrees of freedom, so maybe I will not get exactly a pure state for B, I will get something that has a mix, but it will still not be the correct zone state. Let's go over to the microcanonical ensemble for B alone. Okay, so we know the size of this ensemble is now a finite dimension of Hilbert space, because it's a microcanonical ensemble. Of course, we're doing the usual thing, so usually you have canonical ensemble, you can go over to the microcanonical ensemble by looking at the expectation value of the energy, fixing that to be the energy of the microcanonical ensemble, and then in the thermodynamic limit, you're guaranteed that the number of states of that energy is E to the entropy of the canonical ensemble. That's all that's using. I have no idea how to even discuss this. I mean, the setting is completely different. I cannot put this to a heat bath. I cannot extract both energy at infinity. I don't see the connection at all. If I'm coupling off these things, it's unstable. So it's not a well-defined setup at all. We can try to make it well-defined, but maybe we should put it after my talk. It's a thing. It is like the radiation in that cavity. It's a thing. It's rapid. Well, you have a scale like the area, and the question is what the cutoff is. So if you make the cutoff such that it's a lot less, then it's just a thing, of course. Yeah, whenever you make the cutoff, that's going to also affect how bad the firewall is. If you make the cutoff to lower energies, then the firewall can be sure about that firewall that makes higher energies, but it's also. So it's like the picking cutoff. It doesn't really help. So in this case, the microcanonical ensemble factorizes the picking over separately for each network space, for P and for H. They call these microcanonical hilbert spaces that are finite, T bar and H bar. Like any other product hilbert spaces, will be spanned by a product state basis. And now, D by itself, in every basis element, is pure. The zone is pure, so it can't possibly be part of a vacuum state, no matter what identifications you make. If there's a firewall in every basis state in a moving basis, from black hole, or plane. Now we have to discuss what if